Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Let's Talk, How English Conversation Works, by David Crystal, narrated by Paul Woodson. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus content of conversational transcripts. Please visit tantor.com and type Let's Talk into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the supplemental contents section, please enter the access code SPEAK and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. Preface. I first found myself transcribing and analyzing conversation for Randolph Quirk's Survey of English Usage at University College London in 1962. A decade later, along with the assistant director of the survey, Derek Davey, I made a set of recordings of everyday informal conversation, from which extracts were selected for a book, Advanced Conversational English, Longman, 1975, written with the needs of teachers of English as a second language in mind, but now long out of print. I revisited these recordings as a primary source for the present book, and they can now be heard on my website, davidcrystal.com. It can be difficult getting a sense of the natural flow of conversations just from a transcription, so I do recommend listening to the examples I use. For more recent illustrations of conversation and a wider range of speakers, I've used recordings available in modern corpora as well as clips from YouTube. Innumerable writers have reflected on the nature of conversation over the centuries, and I've included many quotations from them, from Cicero onwards, to provide a kind of literary counterpoint to my linguistic description. I've made considerable use of the collection Hilary Crystal and I compiled for our anthology, Words on Words, Quotations About Language and Languages, 2000, especially the section on conversation, though supplemented by extracts from writing that has appeared since then. The first edition of Words on Words is another of my books that is now out of print, but a new text is available as an ebook or print on demand through my website. David Crystal, Holyhead, 2019. Prologue. English has no shortage of words to describe conversations and our manner of speaking, and no shortage of authors who have reflected on them. Some examples: badinage, banter, blether, blurt, burble. Conversation is an art in which a man has all mankind for his competitors, for it is that which all are practicing every day while they live. Ralph Waldo Emerson, The Conduct of Life. The art of conversation is the art of hearing as well as of being heard. William Hazlitt, The Plain Speaker. Chaff, chat, chatter, chit-chat, chitter-chatter, confab. So let me show you how a conversation works. I say something, and then you say something back that actually relates to what I was talking about, as if you were even the least bit interested. Huh? I say. Jody Pico, Between the Lines. Whenever Percy stopped by to see her, Annabeth, she was so lost in thought that the conversation went something like this. Percy. Hey, how's it going? Annabeth. No thanks. Percy. Okay, have you eaten anything today? Annabeth. I think Leo is on duty, ask him. Percy. So, my hair is on fire? Annabeth. Okay, in a while. Rick Reardon, The Mark of Athena. Gab, gas, go on, gossip, gush. The whole force of conversation depends on how much you can take for granted. Oliver Wendell Holmes, The Autocrat of the Breakfast Table. It does seem so pleasant to talk with an old acquaintance that knows what you know. I see so many of these new folks nowadays that seem to have neither past nor future. Conversation's got to have some root in the past, or else you've got to explain every remark you make, and it wears a person out. Sarah Orne Jewett, The Country of Pointed Furs. Harangue, heads up, heart to heart, hint, hot air. Galinda didn't often stop to consider whether she believed in what she said or not. The whole point of conversations was flow. Gregory Maguire, Wicked. Everybody talks, but there is no conversation. Dejan Stojanovic, The Sun Watches the Sun. Jabber, jaw, jeer, jest, joke, kid, mock. Conversation is like playing tennis with a ball made of crazy putty that keeps coming back over the net in a different shape. David Lodge, Small World. Conversation should be like juggling. Up go the balls and plates, up and over, in and out, good solid objects that glitter in the footlights and fall with a bang if you miss them. Evelyn Waugh, Brideshead Revisited. Natter, parley, pillow talk, powwow, prattle. Conversation needs pauses. Thoughts need time to make love. Theodore Zeldin, Conversation. Ramble, rant, rave, repartee, rib. Conversation is never easy for the British, who are never keen to express themselves to strangers, or, for that matter, anyone, even themselves. Malcolm Bradbury, Rates of Exchange. Small talk, spout, table talk, tattle, telltale, tete-a-tete, yak, yap, yarn. What are the factors that motivate so many different kinds of talk? What are the rules that we use unconsciously, even in the most routine exchanges of everyday conversation? We think of conversation as something spontaneous, instinctive, habitual, the most fruitful and natural play of the mind, as Montaigne put it in one of his essays. But there are rules, or if that word is too strong, conventions, fashions, expectations. Conversation has been described as an art, as a game, sometimes even as a battle. Whichever metaphor we use, most people are unaware of what the rules are, how they work, and how we can bend and break them when circumstances warrant it. The analysis of conversation turns out to be one of the most fascinating in linguistic study for that very reason. When two Englishmen meet, their first talk is of the weather. Dr. Johnson, the idler. True enough, but first they must greet each other. Chapter 1. Greetings. People are gathering for a meeting scheduled to start at 9 a.m. Andrew is the first to arrive, soon followed by Steve. Good morning, they say to each other. Nothing unusual about that. In walks Emily. Good morning, she says to Andrew, and then good morning to Steve. Then she does a double take and says, oh, sorry, I've already said good morning to you, haven't I? It seems they met in the car park outside and exchanged the first greeting of the day there. Why does Emily feel the need to apologize? A polite vocal greeting is the norm when people who are about to engage in some sort of interaction meet each other. It is, of course, possible to stay silent, but that would be very unusual. If Emily said nothing on her arrival, it would convey a negative attitude, some sort of private problem, perhaps, or a suppressed antagonism. The norm is to break the silence, to recognize each other with a brief verbal handshake. It's a mutual affirmation of identity, an acceptance by each that the other has a personal role to play in what is about to happen. So if we're greeted a second time, it's as if that first encounter never happened. The double-greeted one might well feel, was I so unimportant to you that you don't even remember meeting me a little while ago? Sensitive double-greeters realize they've made a small social faux pas, so they rush to apologize for it. It's a basic politeness rule in English. We don't say good morning to somebody more than once, and we are good at keeping a mental log of the people we meet so that we don't double-greet. It's a remarkable and totally unconscious skill. But it only applies to greetings. It doesn't apply to farewells. Imagine now the end of the meeting. It has lasted all day, and as people leave, they say good night to each other. Emily is almost the last to leave. She says good night to Steve and goes out. Then, having forgotten a bag, half a minute later she returns. Steve is still there. She picks up her bag and leaves a second time. Good night, she says to him again, and he does the same. Neither apologizes for saying good night a second time. If you're learning to speak English, good morning and good night are two of the phrases you pick up early on, along with good afternoon and good evening. They seem the same, and from the point of view of how they are grammatically constructed, they are. But from the point of view of pragmatics, how they are actually used in the language, they are some distance apart. The same difference turns up in saying hello and goodbye. If we meet a friend at a railway station, we typically say hello, but just once, We don't repeat it as the person gets closer and closer to us. But when the friend is leaving, we can say goodbye emotionally several times. We can even shout it to each other repeatedly down the platform as the train is pulling out. Bye. 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 Some exceptions. There is a situation where we might utter a greeting several times in succession, when we're being jovial. If Jane walks into an office with a good morning, good morning, good morning, it shows she's in a good mood. If Fred arrives at a party and greets everyone with a cheery hello, 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 it's a way of announcing that he's there. People are more likely to take notice than if he used a single loud hello. It also shows that he's ready to party. Saying something three times is a common strategy of speechmakers when they want to make an impact. On this day, in this election, at this defining moment, change has come to America. Barack Obama, 2008. Education, education, education. The top three priorities. Tony Blair, 1997. Of course, there's no fixed limit. We could carry on repeating hello or good evening indefinitely, as Stephen Fry often did to camera when he was introducing the television series QI. In everyday interactions, I've never heard it used more than five times in a row, and even with five, we would probably feel the speaker was overdoing it. Another multi-hello situation is when we're melodramatically expressing a discovery. There are innumerable scenarios. A gardener coming across an unusual plant with a surprised intonation. A scientist observing an unexpected result with a meditative intonation. Someone at a party encountering a pretty or handsome guest with an admiring intonation. It's also the classic utterance of a policeman coming round a corner and encountering a suspicious activity. Hello, hello, hello. Again, it's usual to say it three times, though policeman, judging by film scripts, I have never been with the actual recipient of such an utterance, often make do with two. The intonation is distinctive. The opening hellos are low and flat, and the final one rises, ominously. But with the study of conversation, there are always exceptions to the exceptions. The other day, I heard someone say, "Hello!" a dozen times, each time in a loud, breathy voice, with the two syllables given equal stress. And it didn't seem strange at all. The recipient? An excited dog, greeting its owner after a period of absence, tail wagging furiously. With each burst of canine energy, the owner responded with an animated, "Hello!" Unusual sequences. Good morning is said in the morning, good afternoon in the afternoon, and good night at the end of the day. True? Not entirely. Good morning in the afternoon. Jane has had a very long lie-in, after a very late night, and doesn't rise until 2. As she staggers downstairs, she is met by her flatmate with a lively, or sarcastic, "Good morning." Good afternoon in the morning. David arrives late at the office. He should be there by 9, but traffic has held him up, and he doesn't get to his desk until 10. He is greeted by a chorus of mocking "Good afternoons" from his colleagues. And perhaps by a sarcastic "good afternoon" from his boss. Good night in the morning or afternoon. The party went on very late, but Peter has had to go to work as usual. As he sits at his desk, one of his wide-awake colleagues notices him dozing off, pats him on the back with a cheery "good night," and thereby wakes him up. It's not difficult to think of other scenarios that illustrate exceptions to the general rule, and the same applies to other greetings and farewells. The response to hello is hello, and the response to goodbye is goodbye. True? Again, not entirely. Hello followed by goodbye. Mary is in a hurry, leaving the office. As she rushes out of the front door, she meets Arthur coming in. "Hello," says Arthur. "Goodbye," says Mary, perhaps adding an apology to avoid sounding too abrupt. "Sorry, got a train to catch." Goodbye followed by hello. As seen in this internet headline. General election 2017. Goodbye and hello. Who has a seat? Nick Clegg will be saying goodbye to Westminster, but who will be returning? Good morning followed by hello. When people who know each other exchange an informal greeting, they often dispense with a symmetrical exchange. A good morning may be acknowledged by a friendly hello, hi, or similar response, or the other way round. Good morning followed by no response. When a greeting is addressed to a group of people, a response is optional, and often inappropriate. Sitting in the departure lounge at St. Pancras International, a businessman joined a group of 5 fellow travelers and greeted them with a cheery, "Good morning." They all acknowledged his presence with their faces, but none of them replied with a vocal response. In another group nearby, a similar greeting attracted a corresponding good morning from just one member of the party, the others evidently accepting that this would suffice for all of them. In addressing a large group, such as a lecture audience, the lecturer's good morning would usually be considered to be no more than a piece of conventional politeness, and be received in silence. Indeed, it would be somewhat odd if someone in the back row were to shout out, "Good morning," in reply. On the other hand, in a church setting, a priest's "Good morning, everyone," to the congregation received a sporadic chorus of, "Good morning, Father," in reply. It seems that there is no general rule. Rather, we need to observe the norms of a particular situation and decide whether we wish to follow them or not. The good morning scenarios illustrate an exchange restricted to a single turn. Each person speaks once. They would never be described as conversations. As we'll hear in the next chapters, to count as a conversation, there needs to be more substance. But greetings do clearly display one of the basic notions in conversation analysis, the concept of turn-taking. A single contribution from a speaker is called a conversational turn. It's one of several metaphors that linguists use to capture the essence of shared talk. Another is the conversational ball. I hold the ball while I'm talking and pass it to you when it's your turn, and then you pass it back to me, when the conversation is running smoothly, of course. I'll talk about cases where it isn't later. Neither metaphor is new. In the 18th century, Jonathan Swift was one who talked about the ball of discourse, and it is this historical perspective that I find especially illuminating as a way into the investigation of conversations today. I used the term pragmatics at the beginning of this chapter, and it's a perspective from this field in linguistics that will provide a frame of reference for much of this book. The name is an application of the everyday use of the word pragmatic. Someone who is pragmatic, according to the Oxford English Dictionary, deals with matters in accordance with practical rather than theoretical considerations or general principles, aiming at what is achievable rather than ideal. Matter of fact, practical, down to earth. There's an implication of adaptability, of altering our behavior to suit the needs of a situation. It contrasts with dogmatic, where no such flexibility is tolerated. The notion appealed to linguists because it tied in perfectly with the concept of choice, a notion that is central to language use and a major focus of several linguists, such as Michael Halliday. We constantly make choices when using language, choosing one word rather than another, or one grammatical construction, pronunciation, or punctuation mark rather than another. We make stylistic choices, such as deciding whether to be formal or informal, and this will be a major factor in talking about conversation. Teachers are always dealing with choice when they correct the work of their students. A correction is an identification of a wrong choice on the part of the student. And later, in Chapter 16, we'll hear cases of people who are unable to make appropriate linguistic choices because of some disability. My definition of pragmatics, accordingly, is the study of the choices, appropriate or inappropriate, we make when we use language in different situations, the reasons for those choices, and the effects that those choices convey. Good mornings. The series of examples in Chapter 1 illustrates a very important feature of conversation, especially in informal settings. It's essentially creative and unpredictable character. There are clearly norms, conventions, and expectations, but it doesn't take much for people to find ways of departing from them for all sorts of reasons. We may wish to convey an atmosphere, build rapport, make an impact, create an effect, trigger a laugh. And our choice may be tacitly acknowledged, given a minimal response, or even become a talking point, as in Chapter 1 of J.R.R. Tolkien's The Hobbit, when Bilbo meets Gandalf. "Good morning," said Bilbo, and he meant it. The sun was shining and the grass was very green, but Gandalf looked at him from under long bushy eyebrows that stuck out further than the brim of his shady hat. "What do you mean?" he said. "Do you wish me a good morning, or mean that it is a good morning whether I want it or not, or that you feel good this morning, or that it is a morning to be good on?" "All of them at once," said Bilbo, "and a very fine morning for a pipe of tobacco out of doors into the bargain." Gandalf tells Bilbo he is looking for someone to share in an adventure. He stays looking at Bilbo in silence. Bilbo tries to ignore him until. "Good morning," he said at last. "We don't want any adventures here, thank you. You might try over the hill or across the water." By this he meant that the conversation was at an end. "What a lot of things you do use good morning for," said Gandalf. "Now you mean that you want to get rid of me, and that it won't be good till I move off." And indeed, a good morning, or afternoon, evening, is often used as an indication that a conversational encounter has come to an end, as an alternative or supplement to other expressions of closure, such as thank you or goodbye. It may be no more than an optional vocal nod of politeness, as when leaving a shop or restaurant, or passing someone in the street. It may be abrupt and cold, as when Scrooge, in the opening chapter of Charles Dickens's A Christmas Carol, uses good afternoon 4 times to stop his nephew's enthusiastic flow, ending in yet another unusual sequence. "A Merry Christmas, Uncle!" "Good afternoon," said Scrooge. "And a Happy New Year!" "Good afternoon," said Scrooge. At the close of an interview or audition, a thank you to the candidate, followed by a goodbye, could suggest a greater degree of finality. "We don't expect to see you again," i.e., you haven't got the job, than a thank you followed by a good morning. It isn't just Bilbo who uses good morning in a remarkable number of ways. Chapter 2. In the Beginning. In the beginning, talk had nothing to do with it. When the word conversation came into English from French in the 15th century, it meant living or being in a place or among people. A common reflection was to refer to one's future state in the next world. "For our conversation is in heaven," says St. Paul in chapter 3 of his epistle to the people of Philippi, King James Bible translation 1611. More modern versions would replace this by a different noun, such as citizenship or homeland. It was also a common way of referring to a circle of acquaintance or one's place in society. In the first translation of Don Quixote in 1620, the good knight quotes a proverb: "You may know the man by the conversation he keeps." Book 6, chapter 27. Today we would say company. Conversation then chiefly referred to behavior, to the way people conducted themselves in daily life. This is how Shakespeare uses the word, as when Enobarbus describes Octavia as someone of a holy, cold, and still conversation. In Antony and Cleopatra, Act 2, Scene 6, line 121. And the notion of living or being together soon led to more intimate senses, including sexual ones. According to Richard, Duke of Gloucester, one of the reasons for the downfall of Hastings was his conversation with Shore's wife. Richard III, Act 3, Scene 5, line 31. The legal concept of crimcon, criminal conversation, was a regular source of public scandal in the 18th century. This was an action that allowed a husband to obtain damages from the lover of his adulterous wife. There was no similar action available for women. The nonverbal nature of conversation in its early use is clearly shown in an observation by the 16th century musician and theologian John Marbeck. A comment in his Miscellany of Commonplace Thoughts, 1581, reads, "True piety doth not consist in knowledge and talking, but in the action and conversation." The modern vocal sense begins to emerge in the 16th century, with a first recorded use by Sir Philip Sidney in his prose romance Arcadia, 1590. There's a clear vocal sense presented when Philoclea goes up to Pamela's chamber to joy her thoughts with the sweet conversation of her beloved sister, Book 2, line 145. And this was well established by the time Dr. Johnson compiled his dictionary in 1755. His definition of conversation is a particular act of discoursing upon any subject. What did people say before this vocal sense developed? How would they have said, have a conversation in Middle English? They would make a dialogue, have a speak, or have a speech. And earlier, in Old English, they would simply have speech. Bede, in his Ecclesiastical History, records how the kings Oswy and Egbert have done betweoch him spreche, had between them conversation, in order to decide what needed to be done about the state of the English Church. We see the full flowering of the modern vocal sense in Jonathan Swift's Polite Conversation, 1738. In full, a complete collection of genteel and ingenious conversation, according to the most polite mode and method now used at court and in the best companies of England. This was entirely about social chit-chat. The author, one Simon Wagstaff Esquire, records three dialogues, at breakfast, dinner, and tea, satirizing the banality of everyday social discourse, full of the formulaic greetings and leave-takings, the slang and catchphrases, the mild oaths and colloquialisms widely used in the early 18th century. His intention, he avers in his introduction, is to be helpful, having observed with much grief, how frequently both gentlemen and ladies are at a loss for questions, answers, replies, and rejoinders. However, my concern was much abated when I found that these defects were not occasioned by any want of materials, but because these materials were not in every hand. For instance, one lady can give an answer better than ask a question. One gentleman is happy at a reply, another excels in a rejoinder. One can revive a languishing conversation by a sudden surprising sentence. Another is more dexterous in seconding. A third can fill the gap with laughing or commending what hath been said. Thus fresh hints may be started, and the ball of discourse kept up. But alas, this is too seldom the case, even in the most select companies. How often do we see at court, at public visiting days, at great men's levees, receptions, and other places of general meeting, that the conversation falls and drops to nothing, like a fire without supply of fuel? This is what we all ought to lament, and against this dangerous evil, I take upon me to affirm that I have in the following papers provided an infallible remedy. Here are the opening exchanges of his Polite Conversation. Lord Sparkish meets Colonel Atwit in St. James's Park. As is usual in 18th century dialogue, proper names are italicized. In this audiobook, they are emphasized. I gloss the expressions that are obscure today. Colonel.
Well met, my lord.
Lord Sparkish.
Thank you, Colonel. A parson would have said, I hope we shall meet in heaven. When did you see Tom Neverout?
Colonel.
He's just coming towards us. Talk of the devil.
Neverout comes up. Colonel.
How do you do, Tom?
Neverout.
Never the better for you.
No better for your asking.
Colonel. I hope you're never the worse. But where's your manners? Don't you see my lord Sparkish?
Neverout.
My lord, I beg your lordship's pardon.
Lord Sparkish.
Tom, how is it? What, you can't see the wood for the trees? What wind blew you hither?
Neverout.
Why, my lord, it is an ill wind that blows nobody good, for it gives me the honour of seeing your lordship.
Colonel.
Tom, you must go with us to Lady Smart's to breakfast.
Neverout.
Must? Why, Colonel, must is for the king.
Only kings have the right to be so peremptory. Colonel, offering in jest, to draw his sword.
Colonel. Have you spoke with all your friends?
Asked them to support you in a duel.
Neverout. Colonel, as you are stout, be merciful.
Lord Sparkish.
Come, agree, agree, the law's costly.
Colonel, taking his hand from the hilt.
Neverout. What, do you think I was born in a wood to be scared by an owl?
Proverbial owls don't scare those who live near a wood.
Colonel.
Well, Tom, you are never the worse man for being afraid of me. Come along.
Neverout.
I'll wait on you. I hope Miss Notable will be there.
Egad.
A gentle oath, by God. She's very handsome, and has wit at will. Can be witty whenever she pleases.
Colonel.
Why, everyone as they like.
everyone to their liking, as the good woman said when she kissed her cow.
And they arrive at the house. The conversation continues in this vein for over 700 turns. Apart from the 18th century idioms and some minor grammatical differences, the language of this repartee isn't very different from what we would hear today. There seems to be a core of conversational strategies that haven't changed, and not just since the 18th century, as we'll hear in Chapter 3. New contexts for conversation. The word conversation greatly extended its range during the 18th century. It came to be used to describe a regular social occasion, an at-home, where people met to talk about things, what would later be called a conversazione. "Lady Pomfret has a charming conversation once a week," writes Horace Walpole in his correspondence, 1740. This didn't mean that her social talk was restricted to a single occasion. In painting, a new genre evolved, the conversation piece, where we see a group of people informally engaged in talking to each other. They're usually seen in gardens, or in the countryside, or in elegant drawing rooms, as in The Marriage Settlement, 1745, by William Hogarth. A great deal of serious chat is clearly taking place. But conversations are not just the province of the upper classes. Hogarth portrayed a rather different kind of setting in his etching A Midnight Modern Conversation, 1733. A tavern drinking scene in which 11 men sit around a punch bowl in various stages of vocal inebriation. One is half asleep, another has fallen over. A chamber pot overflows in the corner. By the end of the century, and into the next, the notion of having a conversation was so well established that fashionable society found it necessary to find new ways and means to facilitate it. Conversation chairs are described in Thomas Sheraton's The Cabinet Maker and Upholsterer's Drawing Book, 1791. The conversation chairs are used in library or drawing rooms. The parties who converse with each other sit with their legs across the seat and rest their arms on the top rail, which, for this purpose, is made about 3.5 inches wide, stuffed and covered. Victorian furniture makers developed the concept further. The two seats were joined, but in opposite directions, so that the parties could easily turn to face each other over a shared rail. Some airline seats in business class are designed on the same principle. Then, towards the end of the 18th century, there was a craze for conversation cards on both sides of the Atlantic. An advertisement in the Baltimore Daily Intelligencer for 1794 read, "A new and elegant edition of the much-admired conversation cards, containing a variety of amusing, entertaining, and innocent questions and answers in the art of courtship. Each pack contains 64 cards." Later, towards the end of the Victorian era, they developed into flirtation cards, also called escort or acquaintance cards. The card would have a simple message on it, such as, "May I see you home?" or a more elegant, flowery, or cheeky invitation. Usually slipped surreptitiously by a man to a woman at a social gathering, there were also answer cards available to accept or deny the request. Some of the cards anticipated the chat abbreviations of internet times. "May I see you home?" reads one. The practice died away during the early 20th century. Today, of course, such invites would probably arrive as a text message. Another popular development towards the end of the Victorian era was the conversation suite, a small circular suite with an embossed message introduced by the Yorkshire firm of Joseph Dobson. At first called conversation lozenges, they contained a moral or romantic message, such as, "Take ye not to strong drink," or, "Give me your heart." The New England firm of Necco had a similar range of candies in such shapes as hearts, baseballs, and horseshoes. The heart-shaped lozenges known as sweethearts soon achieved literary fame. We find them mentioned in Canadian author Lucy Maud Montgomery's Anne of Green Gables, 1908, written soon after the candies were introduced. "Once, when nobody was looking, Gilbert took from his desk a little pink candy heart with a gold motto on it, 'You are sweet,' and slipped it under the curve of Anne's arm. Whereupon Anne arose, took the pink heart gingerly between the tips of her fingers, dropped it on the floor, ground it to powder beneath her heel, and resumed her position without deigning to bestow a glance on Gilbert. A century later, the same principle motivated love hearts from Swizzle Matlow in the UK, the messages always in capital letters. You're fab. Be good. Love you. Bye-bye. Cool dude. Guess who? A popular children's pastime is to take a handful and arrange them into messages for friends. There are adult equivalents, rather more risque in character. The supermarket firm Asda in the UK has a range called Whatevers containing present-day catchphrases and slang, such as bothered, you what? Respect, and mint. In the USA, a handful from a packet brought to light awesome, email me, LOL, and you are a cutie. The texting abbreviation craze must have been the answer to a prayer for the manufacturer's creatives, always keen to find new messages. The word conversation, in its modern English sense, is only some 400 years old, but the phenomenon of conversing, one assumes, is going to be as old as the language itself. Is there any evidence? Conversation cards. Flirtation card. Might I dare, I fain would ask, that you would give word or sign, how I my true love might declare, and learn my fate at Cupid's shrine. Conversation cards died away? Not entirely. In part 4 of Monty Python's The Meaning of Life, 1983, we see a waiter, John Cleese, in a restaurant coming up to a retired couple, Mr. and Mrs. Hendy, Eric Idle and Michael Palin, who are sitting opposite each other in an awkward silence. Waiter. Good evening. Would you care for something to talk about? Handing out menus. Mr. Hendy. Oh, that would be wonderful. Waiter. Our special tonight is minorities. Mr. Hendy. Oh, that sounds really interesting. The couple eventually choose philosophy, and to help them get started, he hands out conversation cue cards. The scene can be viewed on YouTube. The process has a serious analog in the popular conversation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.